Thank you very much. Yeah, thank you for a nice introduction. Yeah. So, Honorable Professor Effie Kartini, Professor Alan Drew, and distinguished invited speakers, all participants, ladies and gentlemen, selamat pagi, very good morning, everyone. Maybe early morning for someone, or even good night for anyone else. So, actually, it is a great pleasure for me to join this conference, and also a great honor for me to deliver an opening remark and plenary speech in this great occasion. So first of all, I have to disclaim, as already introduced by Prof. Ari Budiman, that I'm not an expert in battery, of course, yeah? And even in material science, yeah, I'm just a theoretical physicist, majoring on elementary particle physics, yeah, or we call it also high energy physics. And secondly, I would like to greatly appreciate Pak Tan and also Prof. Effie for your continuing support and efforts and dedication to the battery research in Indonesia. So I know Prof. Effie since long time ago, and she plays, I think, a pivotal role in material research, and in particular battery research in this country. So no wonder right now she is becoming the president of Material Research Society Indonesia. So, and then taking this opportunity, I would like also to express our deep condolences for Dr. Bambang Priyandoko, yeah, who passed away last week, and he is one of our colleagues. Yeah, I think some of you know him very well. And he is also an active battery researcher in this country since many years ago. So for sure, his death is a great loss for our scientific community, in particular material and battery research communities in Indonesia. So finally, I would like to congratulate you all for having this international conference, and I wish you having nice and fruitful discussion during the conference. Okay, so may I have my presentation, please? Yeah. Oh, next, please. Lanjut. Next, please. It's not coming yet. So, before presenting briefly what we have done with BRIN, the Badan Riset dan Inovasi Nasional, yeah, the National Research and Innovation Agency, yeah, and also many research agencies and institutions in Indonesia in general. Can you show the presentation, please? Yeah. So please allow me to take this opportunity to briefly introduce the newly established agency, yeah, as already introduced by Prof. Arif Budiman. We call as the National Research and Innovation Agency, or Badan Riset dan Inovasi Nasional, or shortly, we call it BRIN. Yeah. So starting from two months ago, yeah, April 28th this year, I have been appointed as the chairman of this newly established agency. Yeah. So BRIN is mainly intended to integrate all governmental research institutions across this country. So in this great occasion, I would like to take this opportunity to introduce three directions, yeah, shortly, and seven targets assigned to BRIN and me as the chairman of BRIN. So first, BRIN has been assigned to integrate the related resources of research and innovation, yeah, either the human resources, the infrastructure, and also the budget, yeah, into a single box. Yeah. So this is very important to overcome the fundamental problem of research in our country, yeah, that is the very, very low critical mass on research and innovation resources. Yeah. So, I mean, in total, it's quite big enough, but all of them are spread over and scattered over too many institutions. Yeah. So, and we will conduct this integration, yeah, integrating all governmental research institutions into a single agency, And we are supposed to realize this by January 1st next year. Yeah, because our fiscal year is started in the first day of new year. So at the same time, we are also reforming the business process and also research management. Yeah, because it is not enough just integrated. Just integrating all of them into a single box and let them do whatever they like. Yeah, it is not enough to just doing that. So we have to reform, yeah, the business process and the internal research management to improve the efficiency and to increase what I call as the purchasing power of the existing budget in particular and also the assets, yeah, under our management. So secondly, having such huge resources in a single hand, we are able to soon, hopefully, creating better research ecosystem. Yeah, by making all of them open for everyone. Yeah, including the industry and academics. Okay, so we can do this. Yeah, by also refocusing our program into something that could increase the value added of. In particular, our natural resources and diversities, yeah, either biodiversities, geodiversities, and also art and culture diversities. Yeah, we already have as the local competitiveness of our country. So far, we have somehow, yeah, ignored the potential of our natural resources and also diversities. Yeah, this would be closely related to the battery research also. Yeah, as you might know, battery involves so many things, yeah, from raw materials to advanced technologies, yeah, to process the raw materials into high quality battery, yeah, with high efficiency and so on and so forth, yeah. And as you might know, Indonesia is right now working very hard on how, based on our natural resources, we can play more important roles in the global supply chains of battery and its derivative technologies, yeah, including the electric vehicles and so on. So we want also to make the Indonesia as one of global platforms, yeah, in some sense, yeah, for natural resources and diversity-based research. So we cannot, because we cannot compete head to head, yeah, and for example, automotive or space technology, yeah. But we do have already, as I mentioned, yeah, a local competitiveness coming from our biodiversity, for instance. Yeah. So right now, in regard to biodiversity, for example, we are constructing the global platform for biodiversity research in at Cibinong Science Center, yeah, in Cibinong area. Also, for another examples, in terms of geodiversity, we are also constructing the space observation site at Kupang, yeah, the new one. And we have also established a fleet of research vessels for oceanic research, and all of them should be made it open for everyone, yeah, including the global researchers. Yeah. So, and all of them are important, not for showing off our research, of course, yeah. But it is very crucial to attract the best talent from all over the world, yeah, to work and to conduct excellent research in Indonesia. Yeah. This is the best way, yeah, to transfer, yeah, to enable you know, smooth transfer knowledge and skill, and to provide an opportunity at the same time, yeah, for our younger generation to learn from the global experts in the respective fields. Yeah, so from my opinion, this kind of conference, yeah, today is a kind of activities supporting also the same idea I just mentioned. And finally, we have been asked also to, at the end of the day, yeah, make the research and innovation as a foundation of a sustained and strong Indonesia economy in the future, yeah, which should be focused more on digital economy, green economy, and also blue economy. So that is while we strengthen our research capacity and competencies, yeah, we also encourage the private sector involvement by making all of our infrastructures open for everyone. So we provide an opportunity, yeah, shortly speaking, to our local industries and business players to conduct R&D based product development, yeah, without they need to invest a lot on, for example, human resources, yeah, like researchers and infrastructures for their R&D. Yeah. So at the same time, we provide BRIN as a transition hub, yeah, for young Indonesia talents, yeah, scattered right now, scattered over the world, because it is almost impossible to attract talents if you cannot provide proper environment and also excellent infrastructures, yeah, in respective fields. So, and then finally, we also create new business models, yeah, to enable public, what we call as the PPP scheme, yeah, public-private partnership, such that we can increase direct economical impact from any research activities conducted, namely within BRIN, yeah, and that is also important to earn enough revenue to operate and to maintain all of our infrastructures, yeah, and to enable us put our budget more on a new investment for research infrastructure, yeah, for future research infrastructure. So this is all three direction and seven targets we have been assigned so far, yeah. So considering the critical mass problem, yeah, as I already mentioned previously, and also the fact that research in Indonesia is still dominated by governmental research institutions, yeah, unfortunately, and the phenomena of scattered resources, yeah, either the human resources, infrastructure, and budget, yeah. So there are underlying considerations why the Indonesian government finally has decided to integrate all of our governmental research institutions into a single umbrella, namely the BRIN. Yeah. This idea has actually been thrown back since more than half centuries ago, yeah, during the period of the late President Sukarno, yeah, was also going to integrate dozens of national research institutions into MIPI, yeah, that time, yeah, which is later on converted to LIPI, yeah, the Indonesian Institute of Sciences, which I was the chairman until 2 months ago. So I can also tell you that the late President Habibie also had the same vision, actually, yeah. But unfortunately, he was powerless at that time to execute it. So, shortly speaking, yeah, both of them, yeah, since the beginning, they had realized that it is a waste to have so many governmental research institutions in a country. Yeah. So, as also we learn from other countries, we do need many research institutions, yeah, for sure, but not the governmental ones. Yeah. Most of them should be the private institution or at least managed as a private entity. Yeah. So, although they might be funded fully by government. Yeah. So, this is a completely different situation between Indonesia and the rest of the world, I think. So, in most cases, the governmental research institutions exist to mainly conduct frontier research or big science, yeah, in most countries. So under BRIN, we are expected to integrate the world resources, yeah, as I just mentioned earlier, yeah, synergize the program to minimizing unnecessary overlapping. Yeah, overlapping is somehow okay, but not unnecessary overlapping, while we have to refocus the program to meet our urgent needs, yeah, our national urgent needs. So on the other hand, having huge resources, we could improve also at the same time our research infrastructure significantly up to the level which one hopefully could not imagine before. So of course, integrating many institutions and agency would not be enough. Yeah. At the same time, as I already emphasized, yeah, we should also change the whole business process and also reforming the internal research management. So that is what we are going to do within the next few months, hopefully. Yeah. Next, please. So now, what we are targeting after executing this kind of giant integration, as I mentioned before. Yeah. After the integration, we are expected to improve the research and innovation ecosystem using what we call, I mentioned as the consolidated resources we have at our hand currently. So concerning the input components of research in general, there are at least three components, right? That is the talented human resources, in terms of research and innovation in general, that's very important. There are three important components, input components for research and innovation in general. The first one is the talented human resources, the infrastructure, and also the money, of course, Among these three components, the human resources is the most important one, that might share more or less, namely, 70% of the world input for research. And the other is the research infrastructure covering more or less maybe 20% or something like that, and the rest is money. Of course, the money is very important as the initial trigger. But in the world input of input component for research and innovation in general, the most important one is the talented human resources. Okay, so because in research, people is the center. The talent, the excellent human resources is nothing more. That is the center. Because the creativity, critical thinking lead to any invention and innovation is always conducted by human brain. Nothing else. It's not conducted by institution. It's conducted always by human brain. So that's why research management is always about people. About human resources management and so on. And all policies should be considered as people-centered orientation, nothing more. So next, please. So how BRIN could play an important role to accelerate research quantity and quality and to provide, namely, better research and innovation ecosystem in the country? We have initiated a new approach, which we call as open platform consisting of human resources, research infrastructure, and also the either local and also global network. The platform should be open for everyone, as I already mentioned, either academics and also the people coming from the industries as well. So through this open platform, BRIN could play as a hub and enabler for collaboration of multi-parties, either from local or global. And I actually have introduced this initiative since 3 years ago, at least, during my chairmanship at the Indonesian Institute of Sciences. So this is what we are going to extend to the World BRIN from now. So in this platform, the involvement of students, in particular, is very important, the students. So they could be our pool of future talents, for some students who have a passion on research, and at the same time they could be also our agent, for future commercialization, for some students who want to start maybe their own business as entrepreneur, maybe they have a more a strong passion being an entrepreneur, So in order to attract the students, we have established several schemes. Research assistantship, master and PhD by research, postdoctoral for fresh PhD, also the contract based and permanent position at BRIN. For instance, this year we hopefully open 325 new positions. Either the contract based or permanent position as researchers within BRIN. So on the other hand, we also open mobility program to attract some local and global experts to join our research. This is very important to improve the dynamic, the dynamics of our research environment, the quality of our research, and also the research competencies of Indonesian researchers through direct interaction and day by day learning by doing process. So this is very important program. So taking this opportunity, at this great conference, I would like to also invite all of you to apply for and to join us, to apply for our schemes and join our research group, in the future. So you can make use of this scheme also, to initiate the collaboration, yeah, with Indonesian researchers, yeah, not necessarily within PLIN, but also maybe involving some universities. Okay, next please. So before concluding my speech, I would like to mention briefly about some research related to battery and its implementation plan, yeah, for energy storage and electric vehicle in Indonesia. So first of all, here I show you a simple roadmap, yeah, of our lithium battery under the national research priority. So actually some research had been conducted since many years ago, yeah, by several groups, including a group, as far as I know, yeah, a group led by Professor Elvi at Batan. So we try to at least achieve the battery pack for small devices like small size drone or something like that. And also the target of a battery pack for even a small electric motor and vehicle is quite ambitious. Yeah. So more important than manufacturing our own battery, I do expect our researchers in the future would develop alternate raw materials with unique specifications, for instance, for special purpose or needs, yeah, for special purpose or special needs, yeah. So not only just the conventional ones. Next, please. So one of the example of a special purpose battery pack, yeah. For example, I just mentioned is the energy storage system customized, for example, for BTS, yeah, the base transmission system, the BTS tower, I mean, of cellular communication. Because Indonesia is an archipelago country with many small and remote islands, yeah, with of course off-grid electricity, yeah, infrastructure. So we have tens of thousands of BTS towers across the country, which needs you know, so, small power but a stable electricity. Yeah. So this is just one small example. Yeah, the challenge you can try to overcome. Next, please. So on the other hand, we are also preparing ourselves to, you know, to welcome the electric vehicle-based public transportation. Yeah, because even right now, the electric public transportation system already, you know, competitive enough for real implementation. Yeah, the big one in particular. Yeah. Of course, for our researchers in Indonesia, this challenge is, yeah, frankly speaking, is somehow far away from our capacity, I think, yeah, at time being at least. Yeah. So concerning, yeah, in particular concerning rapid development achieved by global players, yeah, from developed countries, including China. Yeah. So this is quite hard challenge, I think. Next, please. So therefore, we have few groups developing electric vehicles since many years ago. Yeah, as far as I remember, since maybe 2005, I think. Yeah, we have decided right now to focus more on developing special vehicles and develop our own niche market. Yeah. At the same time, and in some sense, new business model. Yeah. So why this is very important, I will tell you soon. Yeah. So at least in the case of a battery and its derivative technology, it is important to develop something that has a chance to be a real product in any step of development. Yeah. Because battery technology is one of the most advanced technology. Yeah. Everyone knows that. Which requires heavy research in long time frame, yeah, with very, very tough global competition, yeah, as I already mentioned. So from the funding agency point of view, yeah, namely BRIN, yeah, the current battery research involves, you know, very high investment, and that leads to, you know, it involves a very, very, very high risk. Yeah. We cannot just conduct the related research and then wait for the end result. Either it will be successful or fail. Yeah, unfortunately, we cannot do that. So then, starting from the end of 2019, yeah, as I remember, we switched to develop, you know, differently. Yeah, we switched to develop what we call as the urban mobile system. Yeah, based on individual electric vehicle, which can move autonomously. Yeah, and because we see that, you know, the way people move from one place to another will change, yeah, in the future. Rather than assuming that everyone will switch their existing car into an electric one. Yeah. Or at least we try to introduce a new business model for local transportation that might change totally our culture, yeah, our culture of moving around. And in particular in the big city, yeah, fortunately, yeah, in the big cities across Indonesia, for example, the share riding is quite common. Yeah, and people start feeling it is more comfortable and reasonable. Yeah, due to in particular the heavy traffic jam, for example. Yeah, rather than having their own car. Yeah, some of the people start feeling that it is more comfortable and reasonable to have the share riding, yeah, than having their own car. Yeah, this is I think this is a new phenomena also in this country, as in particular among the younger generation. So what I want to say is our team started developing what we call as the autonomous individual mobile system. Okay. And it is designed to be used within a closed area like our Cibinong Science Center, for example, or Puspitek Research Center for Science and Technology, or maybe also our botanical gardens across Indonesia, and so on and so forth. Yeah? This individual transportation has an ability to bring namely one passenger or at most two passengers, yeah, to the designated destination autonomously, yeah, and charge themselves, yeah, by going back to the nearest charging dock whenever they finish the job, yeah. So just something like you know, autonomous vacuum cleaner, yeah. So it can later be called for its service through smartphone, yeah, when someone needs its service, yeah. So since the system is deployed in a closed and well-controlled area, yeah, for sure, it could meet the current regulations. Yeah, this is the first one. And it requires very simple telecommunication system because this is very well controlled area. Yeah, we don't need to adopt and implement, you know, a very complicated and advanced communication system. Yeah, for tracking and so on. And it requires also relatively small electric motor because only for because it is intended only for one or two passengers at most, and of course then it requires relatively light battery pack. Yeah, so because the size is relatively small, yeah, and use a small electric motor, and the system is able to charge themselves anytime, yeah, autonomously. It doesn't require large capacity of battery. Yeah. Because battery is one of the largest bottleneck in the technology, right? So therefore, we can hopefully reduce the price as low as possible. Yeah. So this is the basic idea. Next, please. This is the basic idea why we started developing what we call as the autonomous individual mobile system. So right now we are concentrating more on this kind of transportation system, and we do expect to have the first prototype within next year, yeah, hopefully. And of course, other ideas on developing, namely new small, smart, electrically powered devices are always welcome. Yeah. So this is just a small example which how we can proceed the research while we at the same time we are trying to create new business model, yeah, new business model with promising captive market already existing in our local area, yeah, or at least we can generate the new business model in this country, or I mean generate the captive market, yeah, in this country. This also shows how important to have an open platform. Yeah, I already mentioned earlier, involving partners from private sector in our daily research activities. Yeah, so we can grab you know, better idea. Yeah, in particular when we try to develop the new business model, making use of you know, the key technologies under development, yeah, in our research group and so on. So the most important point I would like to mention here is rather than trying to turn the conventional car into an electric one and face, of course, head-to-head competition with much more experienced global players, yeah. So we should think, different approach, yeah, based on the unique or at least our local market. This is always our strength, that is having huge local market. Yeah. So one of the Indonesia strength is the big local market. Yeah. So we have to utilize that. So therefore, the development of battery and also its subsequent whatever derivative technologies, yeah, like electric vehicle, yeah, is more than about research and development, yeah, but it should be also about the people, yeah, and how it could bring us to a new lifestyle, to a new culture, and so on, yeah. So next, please. So I think this is all what I can deliver today. Yeah, I think it's already time. And thank you very much for your kind attention. And of course, stay safe and healthy since we are still in the heavy pandemic that hopefully will end in the near future. Yeah, hopefully.